Welcome, everyone. Thank you for being with us today. We're happy to welcome you to the World Inequality Conference and to present to you the World Inequality Report 2022 here at the Paris School of Economics and also online for our remote participants. We're very happy today because it's been 4 years since the first edition of the World Inequality Report. So you might be wondering, why 4 years? Well, those years have been intense and very fruitful for the World Inequality Lab. During these 4 years, we've extended our scope of research and our database. We will be presenting to you now the ecological inequality, which is new. Also gender inequality, which is a new addition as well, but also the extended research on wealth inequality and income inequality. We're also happy today because we have with us Daniel Cohen, who's the president of the Paris School of Economics, and he has the honor of giving a word of introduction. Thank you very much, Daniel. Before that, on behalf of the World Inequality Lab, I would like to thank first the scientific committee of the World Inequality Conference chaired by Facundo Alvaredo. Second, Gemma Pruner-Thomas, who's been helping us with the virtual arrangement of the digital conference. And third, the Paris School of Economics and EU Tax Observatory team, and especially the administrative team, whose help has been essential for the organization of this event. And also the World Inequality Lab team, of course, and especially Lucas Chancel, who is the lead author of the report, for all the work that they have been doing and that we will be presenting to you during the next hours. Without further ado, Daniel Cohen, the floor is yours. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you everyone. I just don't have much to say but to welcome you all. It's a great honor, it's a great pleasure to have you there here with us. This report is long awaited. It's part of the tradition. We are very proud that the Paris School of Economics, the Paris School of Economics is sometimes called the Piketty School of Economics, which is, of course, unfair to all the writers, and many of them came from a long way to attend this. But this is telling of the importance that the World Inequality Lab has taken in our environment. I was just reading this morning our main French newspaper, Le Monde, and it opens up with a very important, interesting interviews by Lucas. So it is really telling of all the things that happened since this World Inequality Lab has been created. So again, it's a pleasure and honor. I leave the floor to Lucas and all the presenters. Hope you will enjoy your stay in Paris for those who are coming here for the event. I see Gabriel just joined. And again, all the best for this presentation. And again, thank you so much to all the team for this extraordinary work, for expanding the scope of your research. It's always a new thing. Don't know what will be the next edition, but already this one has very much improved on our knowledge of all the dimensions of inequality. Thank you. Thank you again, Luca, and all the team.
Good morning, everybody. One thing that you might have noticed with this conference is that we're in the midst of this pandemic, so we had to adapt our technical solutions to the context. And so while we are trying to finalize some of these technical subtleties, now here we can see Thomas Piketty's video address. So the introduction of this presentation starts with Thomas Piketty's video address. I'll let him continue on the screen here. Thank you very much for your attention, also for bearing with us if there are further little technical issues here. We've been struggling a bit over the past 48 hours to ensure that there are smooth transitions here. Thanks a lot.
Hello, I am Thomas Piketty. I am very glad to welcome you at the Paris School of Economics for this World Inequality Conference. Let me first apologize for not being able to be here in person. We just had a baby with my wife a couple of days ago, and I am in paternity leave right now. And also excuse me if I look a bit tired, but you know, I spend a lot of time at night with the baby, as you can imagine. And so, you know, I'm not able to be with you today, but, you know, I want to welcome you. I want to say that, you know, you're going to hear a lot of people in our team present to you our new World Inequality Report 2022. Lucas Chancel, of course, who has been the lead coordinator behind the report. Emmanuel Saez, Gabriel Zucman are going to be there as well. Many of the other key contributors to the report will be speaking today or will be around in the room. I want to thank in particular Rueda Moshrif, who has been our great data coordinator in this report, Félix, François, Olivia, Teresa, Anne-Sophie, Luis, Clara, Ignacio, Marc, you know, Matthew. I cannot thank everyone. You know, over 100 researchers from around the world have been contributed to the World Inequality Database over the years, and several dozen of them have been very directly involved in the preparation of this report, which is really a great collective adventure. And you know, during this conference, during these 2 days, together with the presentation of the report, many of you will have the opportunity to present their research on inequality trends, and this is really a great opportunity to sort of sum up what we know, what we don't know about the evolution of inequality around the world. So let me summarize very quickly some of the key novelties behind the World Inequality Report 2022, which is going to be presented to you this morning. Well, you know, first of all, we've been continuing, of course, to extend our world coverage of trends in income inequality, which has been historically our chief project. But what's really new in this report and in the new updated version of the World Inequality Database is that we now extend our analysis of inequality to inequality of wealth, to gender inequality, and also to environmental inequality, in particular with the distribution of carbon emission. So this has a major impact. You know, these three main novelties have a major impact on some of our key findings. Let me summarize some of them. Regarding wealth inequality, I think this is the first time we have a world view of the wealth distribution from the bottom to the top in such a detailed manner. One of the key findings is the very high level of wealth concentration around the world. You know, if you take our finding at the world level, the bottom 50% of the world population owns only 2% of total wealth, whereas the top 10% owns 76% of total wealth. So this is, of course, an enormous level of concentration of wealth, which comes together with a huge level of concentration of economic power, economic opportunities. Let me stress that this is true throughout the world. So even in parts of the world which are less unequal, like Europe, the bottom 50% would own 4% of total wealth. So this is better than 2% for the world average, but of course for 50% of the population, this is quite small. And in Europe, the top 10% share would be 58%, which gives a bigger share for the sort of 40% in between the bottom 50 and the top 10, but which is still very, very small, and this reflects a very high concentration of wealth. And of course, with the COVID crisis, we all know that very top wealth holders, you know, the top billionaires of the world have become even richer, and this is something that we analyze in the report, and that we show that, you know, it's important to look not only at billionaires but also at the bottom of the distribution, also at millionaires, which are many times more numerous than billionaires. So we offer a much broader perspective on wealth inequality, which as compared to accounts really centered only on billionaires. Regarding gender inequality, we develop a new indicator which is very simple, which is the share of women in total labor income, so the female share in total labor income, which is a very simple indicator of gender inequality that is quite striking, in the sense that if you look today at the world level, the share of women is only 35%, which makes 65% for men. So men get almost twice as much labor income throughout the world as women, which I think gives a view of inequality which is more meaningful than when we compare for a given job, a given occupation, because the whole point is that women actually don't have access to the same job and the same occupation for all sorts of reasons, including, you know, prejudices, discrimination. And what's also striking is that the progress over time has been fairly limited. So 20 years ago, it was 33%, you know, the share of women according to our estimates. So, you know, there's been an improvement from 33 to 35, but, you know, this is not very fast. And in some areas of the world, like China, we actually see a deterioration of the share of women. So this is a new indicator which we believe is important and will be important to follow in the future. Last novelty of the report, and not least, you know, the emphasis of environmental inequality and the inequality of carbon emission. We show that at the world level, there's an enormous concentration of emission. You know, typically the top 1% of the world has total carbon emission, which are bigger than the bottom 50% of the world, which are the people that are going to suffer the most from the emissions of the wealthiest. But this is also true within each country. So for instance, in Europe, the bottom 50% emit around 5 tons of carbon emission per capita, which is roughly in line. I mean, it still has to go down toward 4 or 3 tons per capita by 2030 or 2040, but this is sort of in line with the objective that we all have in mind. But the top 10% of carbon emitters actually emit almost 30 tons per capita, and if you look at the top 1% in Europe, it will be around 75 tons per capita. So the big lesson of this is that we are not going to solve this problem by just having some sort of macroeconomic approach to carbon emission and by trying to reduce proportionally all emissions by the same percentage. You know, it's clear that everybody has to make effort, has to change their living standards and their way of consuming, but we have to ask much bigger effort for the people who emit, you know, 30 tons or 70 tons per capita than those who are already at 5. And so any solution that does not take inequality into account will not be able to address global warming, and this of course makes a link with our analysis of the enormous level of wealth inequality, gender inequality, income inequality, and we very much believe that it's only by taking into account all these different dimensions of inequality that we will be able to address all our political and social challenges, including of course environmental challenges. Thanks a lot for your attention. I'm now going to let the floor to Emmanuel, Luca, and many others who are going to present you in more details our findings. Have a great World Inequality Conference, and I hope very much to see you soon next time. Sorry again for not being here with you today.
So good morning once again. Very glad to be here. So far, so good in terms of logistics. I'll turn to a more detailed presentation of the report over the next couple of minutes before leaving the floor to Teresa Nief and Anne-Sophie Robillard, who will tell you more about the gender part of this report. Then to Roaida Moshrif, who will also tell you about the new developments of the World Inequality Database. And we've worked quite a bit to also offer researchers, but also anybody interested in inequality, with tools to be able to better understand income and wealth distributions and income and wealth taxes. And then Gabriel Zuckman will talk about tax policies, and we'll discuss the chapters on the recent evolutions in tax policy at the global level. And Emmanuel Saez will conclude this presentation. After that, we'll have a discussion of the report by Professor Jayati Ghosh. He is Professor of Economics at Jawaharlal Nehru University in Delhi. And she will also offer us a perspective of global inequalities from the point of view of India. And then we'll have a panel discussion and an open discussion with all of you. So, so far we have a little issue with the pointer of this presentation. So if Pietro here can help me with the slides, I'll just give you a little note so that we can move forward. So, all right, that's the World Inequality Report here. And I just would like to start straight, you know, to the beginning, why we're doing all this. You know, inequality data is a global public good. And what we observe is that, you know, social movements or some magazines, by this I mean rich lists, are pointing towards large wealth inequalities and potentially growing wealth inequalities. But public statistical systems still struggle in most countries in the world to publish up-to-date information on the distribution of income and of wealth. So, you know, this is a basic issue of democratic accountability. This makes it very difficult to assess whether governments are making progress or not. This makes it difficult to assess whether economic policies chosen by electors are good or not for them. And the World Inequality Lab, the World Inequality Database Project, really is to try to, it's about trying to produce this information so that everybody can make up their own mind about inequality. We do not have the perfect solution to reduce inequality. We do not know what is the exact level of inequality which societies need to go to, but the first objective here is to provide enough information so that everybody can make up their own mind and participate in economic debates. This project, as many of you know, originates is not new, and it is based on the pioneering work of Simon Kuznets, Tony Atkinson in the 1950s and 1970s, who used tax data, tax information, combined them with national accounts in order to produce top income or top wealth share series for Western countries, the US and the UK. This project was renewed in the early 2000s by Thomas Piketty, Emmanuel Saez, later on Facundo Alvarado, and a growing team of researchers over the world mobilizing top income and top wealth share data in order to produce these long-run series. And this led to the creation of the World Top Income Database, which was a few years back transformed into the World Inequality Database. This shift from the World Top Income to the World Inequality Database was actually a methodological and a substantive shift. We're not focusing anymore just on top tax information. We're also looking at the full support of the distribution. And for this, we are mobilizing more data sources. So tax data, rich lists, but also household surveys on income, on wealth. And the methodological contribution of this project is the Distributional National Accounts Guidelines, which I all encourage you to have a look if you hadn't had done so before. This is actually a flexible approach to the distribution of national income and wealth within countries. The DINA guidelines offer a method to use the strength of available data sources. So we are concerned about both the positive sides but also the limits of each data source, and this is a transparent and systematic proposal to how to distribute the totality of national income and national wealth, which is for us the one thing that needs to be done if we want to really compare inequalities across countries. We need to distribute the totality of economic growth and not just subcomponents of it, which can often hide important evolutions. This is a cumulative process. Series are constantly improved thanks to better data or thanks to the development of new methodologies to distribute these concepts. This is also a collaborative enterprise. All the data codes are available online so that anybody who wants to participate in the project, who wants to improve the series, can do that. And we very much welcome anyone wanting to do so to come and join us. And in fact, over the years, over 100 researchers have joined the World Inequality Database project. I guess many of you will see your faces on this screen. So that's over 100 researchers over the years contributing to the World Inequality Database from basically all continents. And we are extremely thankful for these long-run collaborations. Now, more recently, we have also developed a series of institutional partnerships. The objective is to come up with common standards when we come to the measurement of inequality. So these partnerships include international organizations like the UN, and we're very glad for the work we've been doing recently with the UN Stats Division, who are in charge of the revision of national accounts, with the United Nations Development Programme that has been a scientific partner in this World Inequality Report, and that is helping us to access more data in the developing world in particular. We've also developed institutional partnerships with statistical authorities around the globe, in Latin America, in Africa, in France, where recently we published a joint report with France Statistics to try to come up with common standards with different groups of inequality actors measuring income and wealth inequality. We're all faced with, you know, common challenges, and really this is the heterogeneity of the data, and so far the low level of standards to distribute national income and national wealth. But we're also all faced with similar goals and similar objectives, and this is how do we develop public data systems that are fit for 21st century challenges that really answer the demands of civil society, of journalists, of researchers, of the business world, of policymakers when it comes to understanding what's happening to growth distributions. And so this is where we stand today. That's the World Inequality Database as of today, about more than 140 countries with aggregate national income and national wealth values, and more than 140 countries with distributional series, at least from the 1990s onwards. We've also recently produced these long-run income inequality series for all regions in the world, starting from 80-20. Onwards, and with these new developments, which we will present in the next few minutes, on global carbon inequality, global gender inequality, and later on in this conference, a satellite project on political cleavages and social inequalities will be presented by Clara Martinez, Amaury Guettin, and other contributors to this new development of inequality research. So where do we stand today? The World Inequality Report is an attempt to wrap up all this wealth of data that's available on the World Inequality Database and to try to present new perspectives on this. So now for the first time, we're able to have these two global distributions side by side, the global distribution of income and the global distribution of wealth. So income inequality levels today are in line with what we were observing in the previous edition of the World Inequality Report. Top 10% captures 52%, a little more than a half of global incomes. When it comes to wealth, the situation is much more concentrated, with the top 10% capturing more, owning more than 3/4 of total household wealth at the global level. And the bottom 50% owns just 2% of it. So this really is thanks to the new work that was done over the past few years. And I'd like to thank Thomas Blanchet, Clara Martinez, Luis Baulouz, and many others for, you know, critical developments in our understanding of wealth distributions over various countries in the world. This is global income and wealth. Next slide, please. Yes, this is the current levels of income inequality across world regions three bars, three groups of the distribution, the bottom 50% in blue, the middle 40% in green, and the top 10% in red. And what we see here is the diversity of patterns. This is something that we were already putting forward in the previous edition of the World Inequality Report, diversity of inequality levels, diversity of trends over the past decades, showing that extreme inequality is never a fatality. Extreme inequality is essentially due to political choices rather than deterministic forces of globalization. Here, I'd just like to stress two things. First, the top 10% varies between 30-35% in most equal regions of the world, up to 60% or more in very unequal regions like the Middle East, Sub-Saharan Africa. And the question is, where do these strong differences in inequality levels come from when we compare countries with one another? This is a new result from this report. We have new estimates for the distribution of income before taxes and also after all taxes and transfers are taken into account. I'd like here to thank Matthew Fisher-Post and Carmen Durer for their work on these series. And so what you see on this graph is on the horizontal axis, inequality levels before taxes, as measured by the gap between the average income of the top 10% of the population divided by the income of the bottom 50% of the population. And on the vertical axis, you have the same indicator, but after taxes. And what you see here is that, in fact, the majority of the differences in inequality levels after taxes are already there before taxes. So redistribution matters, but it's not going to radically reshift the map of inequality levels over the world. So this means that predistribution is key. But we'll talk a little more about this later. Predistribution is key. This doesn't mean that taxes don't matter. For one thing, taxes finance predistribution, like public services, for instance. So rich countries, which are at the bottom left of the graph here, have total tax rates around 30% to 50% of their GDP. And very unequal countries on the top right corner of the graph indeed have much lower macroeconomic tax levels, from 5% to 20% of their GDP. So this is one way to look at the role of taxes, not just as a way to reduce post-tax inequality levels, but also to stress their importance in limiting primary income inequality, in limiting pre-tax inequality levels. We'll talk a little more about that later on when Gabriel discusses tax policy developments. Now, if some countries have managed to some extent to reduce income inequality levels, I'm thinking, for instance, about European countries, when we look at wealth inequality, well, and especially at the share of wealth possessed, owned by the bottom 50% of the population, it really strikes us that basically no region or no country on earth is really able to limit wealth inequality at the bottom. The bottom 50% wealth share is systematically below 5%. So this level remains extreme basically everywhere. And the report, you know, provides this snapshot into our understanding of global inequality today and also looks at the dynamics over the past decades. And this is what I'll show and I'll discuss in the next few slides. So we're shifting to the global level. Perhaps a well-known graph that looks like an elephant, the so-called elephant curve. In the previous edition of this report, we were focusing on global income elephant curves. This is a global wealth elephant curve. So on the horizontal axis, you have the full world population ranked from the lowest wealth groups on the left to the richest wealth groups on the right. So we're looking at the different percentiles of the global wealth distribution, and the top group, the top 1%, is itself split into smaller fractals. For each of these groups, the graph plots the average annual wealth growth rate over the past 25, 26 years. What we observe here is this shape that we know from the income dynamics that were discussed in the previous edition of the report. And so relatively high growth rates for the global wealth middle class, over 4% average annual wealth growth rate, a decline in wealth growth for the middle and the low wealth groups in rich countries, that's what you see around the percentile 70 to percentile 99, and then very high wealth growth rates, over 5%, reaching 9% in certain cases. So a very unequal pattern at the very top. And what also matters here is the two blue boxes at the bottom of the graph, because a relatively important growth rate of your wealth when you don't own much, in fact, in absolute values, indeed doesn't necessarily mean a lot of absolute increase. And this is what the two boxes at the bottom reveal. The poorest half of the population, even if it grows at 3%, 4%, in fact captures just 2% of total wealth growth over 25 years. And the top 1% captures 38% of the total. So this is going to translate into rising top wealth share. Here I'm just going to focus on the top 0.01%, for instance. Their share in total wealth has been rising from 7% to 11%, with also a marked increase during this pandemic since the beginning of 2020. When it comes to wealth, and this is also a discussion we had in the previous report, we now have updated data over the past 4 years. We also need to factor in this basic distinction between wealth owned by the private sector versus wealth owned by the public sector. This is what this graph shows, and what we observe here when we express net public wealth versus net private wealth, that is the totality of wealth of assets owned by the private sector minus their debt, and the same thing for the private sector, we see this growing gap between the net positions of the private sector versus the public sector. And perhaps even more striking now is the negative wealth position of a lot of Western countries. So this decline is due to two things: privatization, sometimes at a very low price, of assets that can be pretty profitable, and the rise of debt. And this is also pretty clear and pretty evident over the recent months. So what does this mean, a negative wealth position? This means like a country like the USA, for instance, if it wanted to repay all its debts by selling all its assets, all the roads it owns, all the hospitals it owns, it would still not be able to repay all its debts. And then US citizens would have to pay a fee to the owners of the totality of the capital stock in the economy. So these situations have political consequences, and these situations arguably make governments in a much weaker position to confront, to address inequality challenges of the 21st century. Now, a few words about the longer perspective. Here, I was stopping in the 1990s or the 1970s. The report provides new results about global inequality over two centuries. And this really is thanks to the combination of all the work that has been done country by country over the past years. All right, so this is an indicator which we have seen before. That's the gap between the average income of the top 10% of the distribution divided by the average income of the bottom 50% of the distribution between 1820 and 2020. What we observe here, perhaps one of the key striking results, is that we see a little reduction in this gap since the mid-2000s. That's the rise of China effect. That's the rise of the emerging world effect. But this reduction in top 10 to bottom 50% income gap is in fact fairly limited when we bring this in a broader historical perspective. In fact, we're still today at levels of global inequality that correspond more or less to what we were observing at the beginning of the 20th century. That's at the peak of Western imperialism, at the peak of a very highly hierarchical world economic order. And what has been happening, in fact, over the past few decades is indeed a reduction in inequalities between countries, which remain large today, but nevertheless, there was a reduction, and a steep rise in inequalities within countries. So the situation today, as presented on this graph, is that, in fact, within country inequalities now represent the bulk of global inequalities. Again, there are still, you know, big differences between countries like India or countries like the US, for instance. But what is happening within these countries is even larger. And I'll skip this slide in the interest of time. And so I would now like to turn to two novel developments of this World Inequality Report. Just one slide on gender, because Teresa and Anne-Sophie will tell us more about it. This is what we were referring to in the introduction, this new indicator about gender inequality, so that we look at the totality of labor income in the world and split this between men and women. So that's, you know, a more systemic indicator than indicators that are sometimes used in these debates when we just look at the pay gap for a given occupation in a given sector. This indicator here is more systemic because indeed there is an inequality in terms of who occupies which sector of the economy, or perhaps who is doing work that is not monetized on the market, but still doing work nevertheless. And, you know, one basic conclusion from this work is that there is still a long way to go to reach global gender parity. And in fact, if we continue at current rates, we still need about a century to reach 50% of global gender earnings for women. More on this in a minute. In terms of new developments, carbon inequalities, and here we show that very large wealth and income inequalities translate into very large inequalities in terms of contributions to climate change. So one thing, climate change is already exacerbating gaps in income, in wealth between low-income countries and high-income countries. Within countries, we're also observing that extreme weather events have more impacts on the poorest segments of the population, basically because they are more vulnerable to shocks. But here we also highlight a strong form of inequality, which is the inequality in contributions to climate change. The top 10% represent about 50% of the problem. So in the end, that's a pretty highly concentrated issue. And what we show is that that's not just a rich country problem versus a poor country problem. There are low emitters in the US, there are high emitters in many developing or emerging countries. In terms of levels of CO2 emissions per year and per person, the global average is about 6.5 tons per person per capita per year. And bottom 50% Europeans, for instance, emit 5 tons of carbon per person per year, whereas the top 10% is around 30 tons in Europe and 73 tons in North America. Why does this matter? Well, you know, all countries have presented climate plans in order to reduce their emissions by 2030. And what we show, in fact, is that a big part of the population in rich countries is already at the target. whereas other segments of the population, the middle class, the top 10%, are well over the target. So this doesn't necessarily mean that we should all go for, you know, strict carbon quotas in the years to come. But this means that any deviation from this equalitarian view of who should do the efforts, any deviation from this view justifies strong redistribution from the high polluters to those who pollute less. Perhaps we'll say a little more about this during the discussion afterwards. You know, one of the conclusions of all this work on income, on wealth, on gender, on carbon inequalities is that societies have a choice when it comes to inequality levels. This is illustrated in long-run wealth dynamics, for instance. Western countries were able, not just during wartime, but also during peacetime, to implement policies that reduce top 1% wealth share. Now, there's still a lot to be done, as we can still see here, as we have discussed a few minutes back. The bottom 50% wealth share remains strikingly low. So what do we propose? I'll say just 2 points here before I leave the floor to my colleagues. One thing is to carry on this work of publicizing, of democratizing access to data. There have been progress over the recent years with, for instance, the common reporting standards under the aegis of the OECD. But what we tell countries is that you want transparency? Well, you know, go to the end of this process and release basic information so that we can evaluate whether or not current developments really make sense, really make actual change in terms of income and wealth distributions, in terms of really making sure that all groups in society pay a fair share of their taxes. And so we make concrete proposals on this front in the World Inequality Report with detailed tables about what we would like governments to produce. This will also help us to significantly improve our income and wealth distributions in many countries in the world where there are still a lot of data gaps that we have to deal with, to struggle with when we are constructing our series. And second point, you know, there are a lot of investments to be made in the years to come. There's this COVID debt issue, and there's this high concentration of wealth over the past decades, which has been exacerbated during the crisis. So we also make concrete proposals about wealth taxes, progressive wealth taxes at the global level and within each region of the world. And in a few minutes, Roida Moshrif will also show you our new global wealth tax simulator, which make it possible for anybody in any country to design their own wealth taxes. Here a little development, we're also discussing about the interest of tying the global wealth tax discussions with ecological policies. So far, we've essentially focused on carbon taxes focusing on consumers. And these carbon taxes on consumers can have an equal impact on low-income groups when they're not designed in a way that ensures sufficient compensation of low-income groups. This was, for instance, the case in 2018 in France with the Yellow Vest movement. Another way to think about climate change and taxation is to focus a little more on investors. Investors, by definition, have a lot of alternatives when it comes to investing in different sectors of the economy. Low-income groups often don't have these alternatives, to shift from, a car to transportation systems. In many regions, many places, these alternative low-carbon transportation systems are still not there. So shifting the discussion towards the taxation of investors, in particular investors in brown industries, in brown sectors, would be one way to take into account in a better way this strong inequality between polluters and these strong wealth inequalities in general. All right, so let me summarize this presentation. We here offer a systematic assessment of global income, wealth, gender, carbon inequalities over 30 years, or more. This really is based on the work of dozens and dozens of researchers that have contributed to the World Inequality Database over the years. And one bottom line, one key conclusion from this work, again, we stress the importance of social policies. There is no deterministic force which is going to determine that inequalities are extreme in some regions and will always be extreme. Emmanuel will say a few more words about this in a few minutes. And finally, we're not able to show you the great website that is associated to this report, but I also highly encourage you to have a look at it. There is a lot more than what I was able to say in these few slides. I thank you very much for your attention, and I leave the floor to Teresa, to Anne-Sophie Robillard and Teresa Neef. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Luca. Good morning. It's a pleasure to be here today and share with you the results of our work with Teresa on global gender inequality. Teresa and I started this work with the objective of addressing a few following questions. The first one is, how high is the female labor income share and how it has changed over time and how it is distributed across space? And the second one is, how well are women represented at the top of the labor income distribution? So with these two questions, I will present a few concepts first and then the results. So as Thomas Piketty said, we use a very simple concept of gender inequality that includes both gender differentials in earnings and gender differentials in labor force participation. We also include in our labor income definition not only the labor income of wage, such as wage and salaries, but also the self-employment or the labor share of self-employment income, which is actually quite significant for a number of developing countries. To give you an example, this represents 31% of labor income in India, 22% in Brazil, 45% in Côte d'Ivoire. And also this the self-employment income is in some countries, in most countries, more unequally distributed than wage income. This is the case, for instance, in China, in Brazil. There are some exceptions, but mostly self-employment income is more unequally distributed than wage income, which is one of the reasons why it matters to take that into account as well. Another contribution is to provide the first global estimate of the female labor income share, and both Thomas and Luca have already presented that global estimate, but we'll give some more details about that. A last contribution is that we gather and compare data on women's representation, among top earners, drawing from recent Weed World Fellows contribution. So as Thomas said, the concept we use is quite simple. Our definition of labor income includes wages and salaries, as well as the labor share of self-employment income. And accordingly, the female labor income share is simply the share of female labor income divided by total labor income. In order to try and measure and to produce that statistic, we will use two different types of data. The first type of data is survey microdata from LIS and EU Silk projects. And we have that for 58 countries. And the second type of data is the ILO series on employment and self-employment by gender, which exists for 180 countries between 1990 and 2019. So with these two data sets, these two types of data, we combine these data and produce what we call our model estimates, the WILD model estimates on gender inequality. And this combines statistical estimates direct statistical estimates obtained from surveys, and these results in the first database of 799 country year observations for 58 countries. We also add points to that database by interpolating between survey year data points when we have them for a given country. And we then also predict an estimate of the female labor income share using a simple imputation method, a regression, basically a regression of the female labor income share on female wage employment share and female self-employment shares. So this approach allows us to estimate the labor income share for all countries and years for which the ILO series are available. And here are the results. This map shows that, so this shows our results for 2019. It indicates that the female labor income share takes a wide range of value from less than 10% to more than 45% across the world. It also appears to be some clear regional patterns. Indeed, we find relatively high values in the former Eastern Bloc countries, and instead relatively low income values are found in the MENA region. The next graph shows the evolution of the labor income share across regions. It appears to have increased across regions, in all regions, since 1990, except for China, where our estimates suggest that the share has decreased since 1990 from 38%, which is relatively high by international standards, to 33%. Also, this graph shows that the increase is relatively slow in two regions, in the former Eastern Bloc countries and in the MENA region. But these two regions are quite different, as you can see, because the MENA region is where the female labor income share is the lowest, while instead the former Eastern Bloc is where the female labor income share is highest. So the next slide then, as I indicated previously, our indicator takes into account both gender differences in earnings and gender differences in labor force participation. If there were no differences, no gender differences, neither in earnings nor in participation, the global labor income share would stand close to 50%. It would actually be equal to 49.5% to be exact. This is the share of the female population in total population. Because we want to understand which of the two components of labor income contributes more, we then decompose our indicator into two ratios. The earnings ratio, which is equal to the ratio of female to male earnings, conditional on working, and the employment ratio, which is equal to the ratio of female to male employment. So if there were no gender differences in earnings nor in participation, both ratios would be equal to 100%. This graph reveals that in most countries, the earnings ratio is lower than the employment ratio, except in two regions, in MENA and in Latin America. In the case of MENA, the employment ratio is actually very low. It stands at around 28% in 2019 and is stagnating, while the earnings ratio stands at about 60% and has been somewhat increasing. Instead, in the case of Latin America, the employment ratio has been increasing significantly and steadily, and now stands at around 70%, which is close to Western Europe and North America. We interpret these patterns as an indication of selection of relatively highly educated females in the labor market in MENA, and in the case of Latin America, the dynamics show, or we can interpret those dynamics as a kind of convergence towards the patterns of Western European labor markets. I now give the floor to Teresa, who will present our global estimates and address the second question.
Thank you, Anne-Sophie. I would like to continue with the question, how do those patterns add up at the global level? And here you can see the global female labor income share and the development from 1990 to the recent day. And we offer two different perspectives on the global female labor income share. Let's focus on the blue bars first. The blue bars show the income-weighted female labor income share. And here we basically really just add up all the labor income in the world earned by women and divided by total global labor income. We can see that this share increases from about 30% in 1990 to about 35% in recent years. And at this pace, we would take at least until 2100 to reach gender parity. And this graph offers another perspective, which is indicated in the green bars. The green bars show the population-weighted female labor income share, while the blue bars give more weight to high-income countries, like Northern American countries, Western European countries, where we've seen some increase in the female labor income share. The green bars give more weight to the number of people that are affected by gender inequality and give more weight to the most populous countries, like China, where we've seen a decrease in the female labor income share, or India, where we have seen stagnation. But both indicators show that while gender parity would be reached when men and women earn 50% each of global labor income, women currently only earn 1/3 of global labor income. And with this, I would like to go take a few minutes and talk about the second question we explore in this chapter, which is how well are women represented at the top of the labor income distribution? And from the gender economics literature, we know that one main contributing factor today for the gender pay gap is that women reach the top of the wage distribution at much lower rates. Women reach the top of the wage distribution at much lower rates than men. This is a so-called glass ceiling effect. You probably know that. And to explore this question, we draw on high-quality administrative data, like tax data and social security records. And why do we do that? Because we know that survey data underrepresents the very high incomes. They are just not very well represented. This is why we, for exploring what's going on at the top of the wage distribution, we need this high-quality administrative data. And we are lucky because we have this a broad network of WIT World research fellows which provided us with this data. And they provided us with this data in a harmonized concept so we can really cross-country compare. And this is what we do here. So our concept is the share of women among the top 10% of highest wage earners. So we take the number of women in this group and divide them by the number of persons that are in the top 10% of highest wage earners. And we see that today women represent about 30% among the top 10% of highest income earners in the US and France, and about 35% in Brazil and Spain. So we are still quite far from gender parity here. However, when we look at the US and France, for which we have long-run time series here, we see that women have already come quite a long way, because in the 1980s, they only made up about 10% among the top 10% highest income earners. In the next slide, we go to the very top of the wage distribution. Here we look at the top 1% of highest income earners, so a much smaller group at the very top. And we see that the glass ceiling thickens here, because women here represent even less in this group. They represent about 17% in the US among the top 1% of highest wage earners, and about 25% in Brazil. So while gender parity would be reached at 50%, women represent a quarter or even less in this group of top 1% highest wage earners. So still a long way to go. And with this, I would like to wrap up the key findings of our chapter. We found that the women's share in global labor income has increased from about 30% in 1990 to about 35% today, which means at this pace, gender parity would be reached at 2100 or even later. But we've also seen that countries have progressed at quite different speeds across the globe, with especially Latin American countries making big steps towards gender parity, while countries like China or in Southern Asia showing stagnation in the female labor income share. We have seen that one main contributing factor to the gender pay gap is the persistent underrepresentation of women at the very top of the wage distribution. And we have underlined this with drawing on data on high-quality administrative data and show that women make up about 17% of the top 1% highest income wage earners in the US and about 23% in Spain. So also in this indicator, of women at the top of the wage distribution, there's a long way to go to gender parity. And I would like to close with the question, how can our research contribute to good policies and paving the way towards gender parity in female labor income. And I would like to start with a policy recommendation that is very dear to us as researchers. We need more and better data. Concretely, this means we would need more survey data for more countries and more years that is harmonized between countries, so we can really cross-country compare. But it also means better access to administrative data, so we can really see what's going on at the top of the wage distribution, at the top of the income distribution. When we look at policies to increase the female labor income share, this is trickier because we have seen quite different patterns of the development of the female labor income share across the globe. But if we want to draw some very broad lines, we can say this. In the MENA region and in South Asia, we have seen that especially the low female labor force participation inhibits the female labor income share to rise. So here governments could really try to facilitate women's access to the labor market to increase the female labor income share. And we've seen from history and from research, there are different options. Like for example, in the former Eastern Bloc countries, within a few decades, the female labor force participation was drastically increased by top-down policies and by law. This is one option, but there are also more decentralized and more bottom-up approaches. There's research by US-American researchers that have conducted an experiment in Saudi Arabia. And what they find is that also misperceptions about social norms inhibit female labor force participation. They find that young husbands in the majority are actually in favor of women working outside of the home, but they think that everyone else still disapproves. But when you correct this misperception of the social norm, this can really increase female labor force participation. So those are just two options. When we look at the OECD countries, we see that the female labor force participation is high, but the gender pay gap is also still high, and the glass ceilings are thick. So here, governments could help women to really climb the career ladder and close the gender pay gap by providing childcare provision also for long hours, for flexible hours, for example. But also companies can contribute to reaching gender parity. Claudia Goldin points out by making workers substitutable also at the executive level, for example, by co-CEOing. This would allow the both CEOs in this position to better reconcile work and family life. And this would help women to actually reach those jobs. And with this, I would like to close chapter 5.
So, hello everyone. I'm going to present today the World Inequality Database, a website, and then I'm going to move forward with presenting the new tools that we provided with the report and already exist on the website. So, the World Inequality Database contains more inequality indicators that there are that we can just put in one report, and it allows you to go more in depth and study inequality in various dimensions, like we see with female labor income share, carbon inequality, wealth and income inequality. So here I'm going to present the website. So if you are interested in cross comparison of countries of in income and wealth inequality, thanks to the international effort, now we can do that. And as you can see, it's like here on the So the top 10% income share, we can do the cross comparison. And also for wealth inequality, we can do the same thing. So if you are more interested in how the data was constructed, you can just go and check the help button for both the map and the graphs to see how the data was constructed for both income and wealth inequality and other data sources as well. So, and also if you are interested in looking at different indicators for the same country, you can see that through the country page. So here I'm taking the example of France. And as you can see, we already see top 10%, bottom 50% income share. And we can add to that, for example, top 10% wealth share. And again, you can see the documentation from the top of the page and download the full data set. So this is about the database so far. Talking about the tools that we accompany the report. So first I'm going to talk about the income comparator. So the income comparator tells you exactly where are you in the income distribution. So first, Let's take an example. So assuming that I earn 2,000 euros per month in France, where would I be in the income distribution? Wild guess. Okay, I will be at the 48th percentile, which means that there are 48% of the population that earns less than me, but there are also 52% of the population that earns more than me. What if, well, is this going to move forward, but this how we present it. So I would be at the 48th percentile. I would earn around 2,000 euros on average, but I would be very far away from the top 1% because I have to at least earn 11,000 euros. But what if we switch in another country? Let's say we go to Egypt, which is my country, and I earn 2,000 euros per month. Where would I be in the wealth, in the income distribution? Okay, so I will be very rich because I would belong to the top, well, I will say, I will belong to the top 11% of the distribution. So from one side, you can see how income inequality it is between countries, because I am almost at the median in France, but I would be in the top 11% in Egypt. But also it gives you an idea that the top 1% even in Egypt can be compared to France, because as I said before, I have to at least earn 11,000 euros to enter the top 1% in France, but I also have to earn at least 9,000 euros to enter the top 1% in Egypt. So inequality in Egypt is more severe than France. This is one thing. Because in Egypt, if I was at the median, I would earn around 600 on average, which means that for me to reach, so if I want to, like I said, if I am at the median of the income distribution in Egypt, I would earn around 600 euros on average, which means that in order for me to reach the top 1%, I have to earn 15 times more. While in France, I would only have to earn like 5 times more. So income comparison can allow you to track inequality across countries as well. Moving forward, so the thing is, we can also know where I would be in at the regional and the world level. For example, I would be at the top 82%, which is the top 20% at the world level. So this is about income, and we can also, the comparator allows you to see like in more details the distribution within the top 1%. Now moving forward with the wealth, I would also take again the example of France. Can you pause? So let's assume I own around 2,000 euros in France. Where would I be in the wealth distribution? Well, I would be very low because I would be at the, Luca? I would be at the 13th percentile of the wealth distribution, which means that there are 87% of the population that own more wealth than me, and mean that I have to at least own 1.6 million to get to inside the top 1%. And basically, the top 1% hold all the billionaires and millionaires in France. And this, we can also do the comparison across the world. So I would fare better at the world level than in France, for example. And it shows you the huge wealth gap between the top 1% and the bottom, because I would have to at least own 700 times more to reach the top 1%. And just like I said, 700 times more almost. While on the world level, I would have to like 3,000 times more own wealth to reach the top 1%. And yeah, the numbers just explodes at the top 0.001%, which if I want to become a billionaire or something. And the same works to see how I have fared if I was at the 13th percentile in 1995. So if I was at the 13th percentile, I would have seen my wealth decrease by 49% up to 2021, for example. So this is about the income and wealth comparator. Luca. I'm going to discuss now the Global Tax Simulator, which is a new tool that accompanies the Chapter 7 of the report about wealth distribution. And if we take into account capital depreciation and tax evasion. And I go to, for example, North America, and I want to design my own tax scenario, for example. So here on the left side, I can choose different marginal taxes for different groups of wealth. Like, for example, can you pause? For those who earns between $500,000 and $5 million US dollars, we would tax him by 0.5%. And then this is rises progressively up to those who own more than $100 billion, where we would tax them 10%, for example. And the good thing about this tool is that if you apply this tax scenario, we would have generated enough tax revenues that would be equivalent to 3.15% of the regional income in North America. And we can also determine what would be the effective wealth tax rate, which would be 5.66 for those. Can you pause? For those who own more than 100 billion, which means that this is the average amount of tax that they would pay as a percentage of their initial wealth. And in this graph, you can see the different effective wealth tax rates for different wealth groups. And last, we're going to talk about the tax scenario. So in that tax scenario, we would imagine if this taxes progressive tax, we would have applied it since 2010. What would be the share of the top, of the wealth share of the top groups? So if I pick, for example, randomly, $10 billion for those who owns more than $10 billion, their wealth share would have decreased from 1.3 to 0.9%, for example, if this tax scenario was applied since 2010. And then I played, of course, with the tax rate and made it way more progressive. And I can see that the wealth share have decreased dramatically if it was applied since 2010. And now I can leave the floor for Gabriel. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. I'd like to start by congratulating the team of the World Inequality Lab for a very important report. It's hard to overstate how useful a resource this is. I've been using it in my teaching for many years now. I know many other professors who do. All the data is online, you know, the methodology, the program, which makes it possible to design, you know, exercises for students to do in class. And I expect this 2022 edition of the report to also become a landmark that will be used throughout the world. So really a big congratulations to all the authors and the researchers who participated in writing this report. I'd like to talk about the chapters on taxes, which are about taxing the wealthy, taxing corporations. The starting point in these chapters is that historically speaking, progressive taxation of individuals and corporate taxes and tax policy in general has been instrumental in reducing inequality in the countries where it has declined over the course of the 20th century, very much including France and continental European countries. Today, however, there is some skepticism that it's possible to use progressive taxation as a way to reduce inequality. And this is due to a number of reasons. This is due to the fact that we live in a globalized world, so there is tax competition. There are new forms of tax avoidance and tax evasion that have been created by globalization. Multinational companies can shift profits to tax havens, for instance, or they can move headquarters to low tax places, or they can move factories and workers. And so in the report, based on recent research in that area, one of the things we try to do is to explain how it's possible concretely to reconcile globalization with progressive taxation or with taxing capital and taxing corporations, if that's what people want to do. So we discussed these challenges that I described and some of the solutions to those challenges. Next slide, please. One of the things that I wanted to mention is that sometimes there's this view that there's a kind of two possible options. You can tax individuals or you can tax corporations, you know, and that these two things are substitute. And the reality is that they're not, you know, they're very much complement. You cannot properly tax wealthy individuals if you don't tax corporations, for the very simple reason that if you try to do that, if you don't have a corporate tax and you try to have high income tax rates, for instance, what will happen is that rich individuals will incorporate, you know, they will earn income through companies subject to no tax at all, in my example, and thus, you know, bypassing the progressive income tax. That's the reason why all countries that have a progressive individual income tax also have a corporate tax, and also why historically, when the progressive individual income tax was highly progressive, in some countries, like, you know, in the United States in the middle of the 20th century, then corporate tax rates were also quite high, typically 50% in the middle of the 20th century. The corporate tax is a somewhat progressive tax, despite the fact that the tax rate is fixed, you know, is the same for all corporations. Typically, it's progressive because corporate profits accrue to people who are predominantly at the top of the income distribution. And that's true even in countries like the US, on that graph here, where a significant share of significant fraction of corporate equities are owned through pension funds. Here, what the graph shows is that about 30% of the corporate income tax is paid by individuals in the top 1% of the income distribution, who earn close to 20% of total income in the US. So that means the corporate tax, you know, even though it's at a flat rate today of 21% for the federal corporate tax in the US, is progressive. It is also more progressive than the average tax, so to speak, in the tax system in the US. The average tax rate of the top 1% is close to the average macroeconomic tax rate, which means that if the top 1% earns about 20% of income, it also pays, you know, about 20% of taxes, slightly more than that. But because it pays, you know, about 30% of corporate taxes, you know, the corporate tax is typically more progressive than other taxes combined. So, you know, bottom line is you should not think of the corporate tax as a substitute for, you know, other forms of taxation and individuals and individuals, but you should very much think of it as complementary. Next slide, please. That being said, the main problem that we face today if we want to increase the corporate income tax is, as I said, challenges of tax competition, of tax avoidance, tax evasion. So how do we address those challenges? Of course, the ideal solution is to have international cooperation, you know, ideally global agreements on improving the taxation of multinationals. And there is, and there has been some progress in that area. So Teresa tomorrow and others in our second plenary session will talk about this. There is progress on a global minimum tax. There is progress on a global agreement to better tax multinational companies, and that's a very positive development. At the same time, because countries have very divergent interests in that area, with in particular small tax haven countries benefiting quite a lot from low corporate tax rates, trying to have a global agreement where all countries are on board puts downward pressure on the agreed minimum tax rate, and that's why, you know, the agreed minimum tax rate in the deal that's being finalized is only 15%. That's the reason why there is also sometimes value, although international cooperation and global agreements are always the ideal solution, there's also value sometimes in unilateral action. And a good illustration of this is what happened with bank secrecy, you know, a decade ago, when I started my PhD here at the Paris School of Economics. There was a complete bank secrecy, meaning that banks in Switzerland and in other tax havens didn't have to send any information to tax authorities abroad. And in that context, it was very easy for wealthy individuals to hide assets by moving wealth to bank accounts in tax havens. And then what happened is that the United States took unilateral action in 2010, basically threatening Swiss banks with economic sanctions if they refused to exchange data with the US tax authority. And under the threat of that type of sanctions, they agreed to cooperate, and this paved the way for a new form of international cooperation, the automatic exchange of bank information, which 10, 15 years ago was deemed utopian. You know, everybody said at the time when there was this complete bank secrecy that it would never happen because how can you force Swiss bankers to cooperate if they don't? The reality is that, you know, sometimes it's possible with the proper incentives, and sometimes unilateral action can pave the way for global agreements. And we've done a lot of work on that in the context of the EU Tax Observatory that Teresa and other will discuss tomorrow. And I think there are interesting lessons for taxing corporations for having a more ambitious minimum tax than the 15% that's currently being agreed nowadays. What about taxing the wealthy? So there's growing interest in wealth taxation globally, which is due to a number of factors. Most importantly, as we show in the report, the fact that wealth globally is growing much faster than wages, than output, than income, means that there's just a hugely dynamic tax base here that's not well taxed, because, you know, most countries have wealth taxes, but very archaic and regressive wealth taxes, namely property taxes, that only tax one form of wealth, real estate, housing. And because, you know, housing wealth is the bulk of wealth for the middle class, but only a tiny fraction of wealth for the rich, just taxing housing is equivalent to having a very regressive tax on wealth. There's a debate on billionaire taxes that's raging in many countries, very much including in the United States, where there's actually a pretty serious proposal that's being discussed right now in Congress to tax the unrealized capital gains of billionaires. So, you know, think of US billionaires as having about $5 trillion in wealth, of which about half, $2.5 trillion, are unrealized gains on typically the shares they own in companies that they founded. And in that proposal, these unrealized gains would be subject to taxation immediately at a rate of 20%. So you do the math, that's very simple. If billionaires have $2.5 trillion in unrealized capital gains, you tax that at 20%, that's half a trillion, $500 billion in revenue from just about less than a thousand taxpayers. And, you know, why does that matter? Not only wealth taxation, for instance, you know, this form of wealth taxation can raise a lot of revenue, but it can address one of the key problems that the tax system of many countries face, namely the fact that the tax system tends to become quite regressive at the very top of the distribution. We showed that in some of our work with Emmanuel Saez in our book, The Triumph of Injustice, in the context of the US. But that's very much true in other countries as well. There's a recent report by Institut des Politiques Publiques here at PSC in the case of France, where it's pretty clear that for French billionaires, you know, tax rates, effective tax rates, when you combine all taxes, you know, the corporate tax, the wealth tax that was abolished, the income tax, effective tax rates are way, way lower than average tax rates. You know, typically, billionaires pay about 15% of their true economic income in taxes in a country where the average tax rate is about 50%. You know, about half of all income that's created in France each year is taxed. So that's an issue that wealth taxation can help address. Thank you very much. Congratulations again to the authors of the report, and I look forward to the rest of the conference.
Thank you. So it's a pleasure to be here to draw some conclusions and perspectives on this incredible work of the World Inequality Report. So I want to draw some conclusions and perspectives on two dimensions. The first one is the methodological dimension, and the second is about the substantive, the dimension, the result. So on the methodological dimension, conclusions is that really putting together this database forced us to think very hard about what is a universal standard for inequality measure. And we realized in the same way that as it was done, you know, for national accounting, that you need to be comprehensive in your definition of income and wealth if you want to do a good job, particularly at the top of the distribution. And that's why you cannot just rely on surveys. You really need to look at the interface, you know, of corporations that are owned by the wealthy and individuals. And so I know that this makes many researchers uncomfortable because it forces you to make a number of assumptions and imputations. But our big conclusion is that you have to do that work if you really want to establish a database that's going to be fully comparable across countries and over time. And that leads me to my second point here. This really forces you to have a pragmatic use of the data available. So we haven't discussed it a lot today, but it is important to remember that there is tremendous heterogeneity in the quality and extent of the data available across a country. And the force of this endeavor here at the World Inequality Lab was to develop methods that would work in any situation, doing the best you can and supplementing deficient data or less comprehensive data with assumption based on situations where you have much better data. And the third point is that I want to congratulate, you know, the impressive coordination in achieving this, you know, through the World Inequality Lab, both in terms of country coverage and also methodology. It's rare to see a purely academic endeavor being able to put together so many studies outside, you know, institutions such as the government or international agencies. So let me move on to the next slide. In terms of perspective, historically, eventually, you know, that work should be handed over, you know, to government or international agencies. That's what happens for national accounting, that is now done, you know, country by country with international organizations coordinating it. Here, you know, so that's what we're saying, is that we hope to hand over this work within a few years to such agencies. But the more we get into it, the more we realize that's really difficult, in part because inequality is much more multidimensional than just aggregate income. And that's why we come to the view that there is enormous value in continuing to get academics heavily involved in generating those data and in a dialogue with government agencies. And I think agencies are crucial because they are the ones that really are going to create or collect the basic data. And in our experience, when you put together a study, you force those agencies to think through about the pieces, the important pieces that they are missing. So today, for example, no government agency is very good at saying much about billionaires. And it's actually magazines who've taken over, but at the same time, they realize that they have a deficit here. And so we academics pushing, you know, the use of those billionaires list can make a real difference. So we should continue that dialogue. And also my experience is that measuring inequality or the tax burden by income groups, that seems simple, something, you know, a government agency could do, but in reality it raises really difficult academic questions. And I think the most, you know, talking to this group to this group of academic researchers on inequality, I think there is enormous value to have academics continue thinking about creating those inequality series, because when you do them from an academic perspective, you really think hard and can help improve, you know, the measurement or modify what you are measuring to capture what you think is important. So let me turn on to the next slide. So substantive lessons. So I'm going to be brief here because a lot has been already said. So we know that inequality varies a lot across countries and over time, and that inequality is tied to the social structure of society and who has power in society. And perhaps this is most easily seen in the case of gender inequality, the chapter that was presented earlier on. You have countries where the social view is that women should not work outside the household. In some Middle East countries, in some European countries, you have the view that women shouldn't work when they have young kids. In most countries, most institutions, you know, the view is that women shouldn't be in very top position. And so that social view obviously plays out in the data, and they are the first, you know, explanation for why gender inequality is still so high. So that is, it's incredibly important that we have this data systematically in the database, because just with that aspect, you know, you have to think beyond, you know, the narrow view of economists. The second point I want to make is that low inequality with good economic development is possible, but it is perhaps rare. Really, the only historical example we have over the last two centuries are Western countries and some Asian countries such as Japan, you know, post-World War II, that managed to put together fast economic growth with low inequality level. That's not the way the new developing countries are growing today, such as China and India. So in net, and that's the work that Luca Chancel presented and did with Thomas Piketty, is that world inequality is always very high. Even though you have some pockets of more equality, either you have a lot of world inequality because there's tremendous disparity across countries. That was the situation circa 1980. Or now, you know, we are in a world where there's going to be a very high world inequality just because most countries are very unequal themselves. Let me move on to the next text slide.
This one. So let me finish by giving you a few perspectives on substance. So as I said, economic development is good to reduce inequality. You know, China and India growing suddenly, that's a great thing to reduce world inequality, but that's not going to be enough. That is, you'll have to lower inequality within countries. Post-tax redistribution is good and very important, but it's also not enough. Namely, the countries that have achieved low inequality achieved to do it on a pre-distribution basis. That is, they were organized in such a way that even before taxes and transfers, inequality was relatively low. So let me move on to the next slide. And so this is a graph that was put together by Thomas Piketty that shows you the enormous development of the social state in Western Europe over the 20th century. So you start with countries in Western Europe that are very small governments relative to the size of the economy, and you can see that grows enormously to almost 50% by 1980. And that period of enormous growth of government corresponds, you know, to that golden era where countries achieve both low inequality and high economic growth. So you look at this and you really feel like even in our Western countries, you know, humans are partly socialists in the sense that we socialize a lot of things, and many of those things are actually enormously valuable in terms of investments for the future. So that's the piece about education and health that are fundamental for future economic growth. And in the most successful countries, that is essentially something that is organized at the social level rather than left to the market. So this is the golden era of perhaps, you know, economic development paired with equality. Now let me turn to the next slide. If you look at the level of the world today, you unfortunately don't see the same development. That is, in spite of enormous economic growth in a number of developing countries like China or India, if you look at the tax rate, the total government revenue or spending relative to national income, it hasn't grown that much. And you can see that at a global level, it is at a much lower scale, you know, where the size of government to total income is more like 20-25%. And particularly worrisome are the two aspects of government spending that are perhaps the closely tied, you know, to future development, which is health and education. And you can see only very small growth. So if I were to come back to the text slide, you know, back to, yes, to give you an advice to researchers on inequality, I really feel like once you look at the data, something, you know, that if you read this inequality report, you obviously need to go beyond the narrow neoclassical economic view of how inequality is formed. The social aspects and power dynamics are going to be a key. So that's why, you know, putting together the data really forces you, you know, to think more like a social scientist than just a narrow economist. It's inescapable when you start really seriously looking at the data. And therefore, I encourage you to think wide about causes for inequality as you pursue your research. Thank you very much.
I'm delighted to be able to join you at this very important launch of the World Inequality Report, because I think it is an extremely important, urgent, essential report for our times. And I think it's not just because of the importance of the facts that it reveals, which are truly horrifying, but because it's a call to action. And that's really what we need at this point. There are really many important conclusions that come out in this report, and we have just heard about several of them. I want to highlight some that seemed particularly important to me and from a developing country perspective. This is a report that highlights how inequality has grown over a very long period. But the terrifying result is that it's actually worse now, or just as bad as it was during the period of peak imperialism in the 19th century. In other words, we are now at levels of global inequality that are similar to the time of Western colonialism, when everybody agrees that it was really unacceptable levels of global inequality. And this is something that is not necessary. The very, very important point that the report makes is that inequality is a political choice, and it is a choice within countries and globally. So in terms of the extent of inequality, the report identifies that very clearly. I would argue that it's actually even worse. Between country inequality is even worse than is presented here, because the report uses purchasing power parity exchange rates rather than the market exchange rates or the actual exchange rates that prevail in the world. And this, we know, tends to overstate the incomes of the poor economies and of the poor in general. Because the reason why a country has a low exchange rate is because it has so many people willing to work at very, very low wages and provide goods and services at very, very low prices. So in a way, the purchasing power parity index actually leads to an understatement of global inequality. And therefore, it's likely that between country inequality is actually even worse than has been presented here. But then, of course, the report makes a very important contribution about wealth inequality, which has grown dramatically faster than income inequality and has now reached obscene levels. Really, there's no other word for it. And importantly, public wealth has fallen across the world in most countries. In some countries, it's now negative. Extraordinary that the public share of wealth has fallen so much that wealth is entirely privatized. And that has huge implications for all kinds of other inequalities, because we know that wealth is also distributed not just according to class, very much so, but also according to gender, according to different social categories. And so it adds to the existing social and economic inequalities as well. The pandemic has made all of this much, much worse. As we know, the pandemic has accentuated wealth inequalities, it's accentuated income inequalities, and some very small proportion of people and companies have profited hugely out of the massive deprivations and crises and catastrophes affecting the rest of the world. There's also an ecological imbalance, which has been very importantly highlighted here. And of course, there is the, if you like, the North-South imbalance in terms of both carbon emissions and the impact on nature, the destruction of nature that has occurred across the world and the impact of that. But there's also the within-country inequalities in carbon emissions, which this report highlights very brilliantly and brings out that, you know, you have very, very high carbon emitters among the rich in the poor countries and relatively low carbon emitters among the poor in the rich countries. So we need to take a much more nuanced and granular view of how exactly carbon inequalities are playing out as well. This is a report which is very strong on redistribution, correctly, and I'm all for it. I'm all for the demands for progressive taxation, wealth taxation, corporate taxation, et cetera. But I think we also have to look at what is called pre-distribution, at the regulatory structures and the systems that enable all this wealth to accumulate in the first place in such few hands and enable so much of the income to be appropriated by a tiny minority of the population or of the economy. So there are many regulatory changes that have occurred, especially since the 1980s across the world, that have made the system so much more unequal and have made it unequal, not just globally, but within countries. There is the privatization of finance, which we know finance itself is highly oligarchic in nature, but the very privatization of it, the reduction in the role of public finance, has really meant that people are thrown into this very inequalizing world and dependent on the whims and fancies of highly mobile cross-border capital. Then there is the privatization of knowledge, the intellectual property rights that, as we speak, are actually killing people. The protection of knowledge that has often been publicly created, like the COVID-19 vaccines. Most of the research and development was either done in public labs or supported through large public subsidies. Yet they are appropriated by a few major multinational companies who are holding on to this, denying other companies the possibility of making it, and therefore reducing the supply of vaccines and ending up killing people, prolonging the pandemic, and et cetera. But that's just one example. The privatization of knowledge has led to massive increases in rents for large corporations who hold patents and other property rights, and has really meant not only that knowledge itself, the progress of knowledge is constrained, but that you're adding to these inequalizing forces. Then there's the privatization of the other commons. There's so much of nature that is increasingly being privatized or has been privatized over the past few decades, which has led to more and more inequality in different ways and is adding to our problems in the global commons in terms of dealing with climate change. The corporate control over agriculture, the growing corporatization, and the ability of large corporations to squeeze farmers and those who produce the essential food that we need and so on, is another aspect of this. And then there, of course, there's the privatization of public services and basic amenities. Water, electricity, health, education, you name it. All of the things that were earlier seen as the preserve of the state are now privatized, providing monopoly rents to these providers. And that, of course, adds to all of the inequalizing tendencies, which then makes it necessary to have progressive taxation, because all the regulatory structures and legal codes are working in the opposite direction. And finally, we've seen that in periods of crisis, it's the rich who get bailed out. It's the large corporations and the rich who get either tax relief or various kinds of subsidies and various kinds of protection much more than the poor. And this is true, again, across countries and within countries. So there are many things that we need to do to ensure that the kind of obscene global inequality that is exposed in this report is a fact of history rather than our future. And I think, therefore, this report is hugely important. It's urgent, it's essential, and I want everybody, policymakers, people in the world to read it so that we can actually all mobilize for progressive change.
Thank you so much to Jayati Ghosh for this very stimulating discussion of the report. Thank you also to all of you for bearing with us with these technical issues that we've been facing this morning. I know it must be very irritating. It's also the case for us here. But we'll try to, you know, continue with the discussion and with the presentation of this report today. Now we have a panel discussion. So I'd like to call to the stage Emmanuel, Gabriel, Teresa, Anne-Sophie, or Roaida. Do you want, you're all invited on stage. And the panel will be moderated by Olivia Ronsin, so communication manager at the World Inequality Lab. We're here to have a discussion with you all. Jayati Ghosh, we're also trying to bring her on stage from New Delhi. And let's hope that we'll be able to solve some of the technical difficulties that we've been going through this morning.
Thank you very much, Luca. Thank you all for your interest. So, we will now be discussing all these issues. And maybe we can start with a very broad question that is going to be addressed to all of you panelists. Can you tell us a bit more about data transparency and the impact that it has on democracies? Who wants to start? Transparency is a big issue. That's what we've been working on at the lab. We've published a data transparency index that rates how countries are transparent on inequality data worldwide. And we know that it's a pressing issue for democracies to be able to really understand what's at stake. And so it's very important for citizens as well.
Thanks a lot, Olivia. Perhaps just one thing to this audience today, audience of researchers. I think the work that has been done by this ecosystem of inequality researchers over the years had one direct consequence, and that's to force encourage governments to release more information. This was very clear for us, for instance, in our discussions with the Indian government or with countries in Latin America or Africa, where after the first wave of inequality series production, several governments actually were a bit frustrated not to be part of the discussion. And the answer was that, well, we don't have access to the information. So that is one concrete positive consequence of the work that we're doing, and I think that's very also motivating for the future. There's still a lot to be done. We've seen that in so many cases basic information is still not there, but progress is possible and progress has been made. And here I also would like to point out to this very interesting report put up by INSEE a few months back in the context of France, where initially you had these various groups of inequality researchers in France, the National Statistical Office, us here at the World Inequality Lab, other colleagues from other groups, coming in the discussion with different views of how things should be done. And we are applying concepts and methods in our own work, and sometimes it's not the same thing as what other researchers are doing. And in fact, this collaborative work over several months made it possible to get to common agreements, common standards, and there was a broad view that we need actually, yes, to peg our work in the national accounts. and to start from this macro aggregate concepts. And I think this is really also a progress in terms of, you know, methodology, data transparency, is really to combine the micro study of inequality with the macro discussion. And with that, we're seeing some progress in certain key countries in the world. So now the next stage is the revision of the system of national accounts. And this is going to happen in the months to come, and we hope that, you know, critical steps can be made with this revision, because as many of you know here, this has been so key, so important to, you know, make GDP the lead indicator for social progress. This is because the system of national accounts at some point of time designed and standardized these concepts. So for us, it's very important to continue to work on this front in the months to come. Perhaps feel free to add different perspectives to this.
So I can add as well that there is a huge problem of data accessibility for especially developing a world, because, well, first, if they're going to provide survey data, it's tabulated. Second, if it's tabulated, it only describes consumption, not income. And then, hence, we make extra assumption in order to correct these surveys. This is one thing. And the second thing is, like, not every country around the world necessarily publish their tax data. So it would be very hard to capture what happens at the top if we don't have the tax data. For example, in MENA region, we have had this inequality paradox, which explains why would, if the Gini coefficient, if it decreases across time, which explains that the inequality have been decreasing, why there has been this Arab Spring that calls for social justice. So the problem is we only focus on the Gini, so it do not necessarily capture the evolution at the top. But also, we don't have sufficient tax data that describe how much. Sorry, that describes how much income accrues to the top of the distribution. So we need to highlight that, because not we know that Gulf countries are super wealthy, but they do not necessarily publish sufficient data, even micro data, to help us construct the distribution of the national account in those countries. But we also provide a lot of ways in order to work with what we were provided in the best way possible.
Thank you very much. I have a question that's more for Gabriela and Emmanuel. So you've been following, participating, and feeding the debate in the US about wealth taxation. How would you characterize what's going on at the moment and the reforms that have been taken in the past years?
Yeah, thanks for the question. So let me say a few words perhaps on wealth taxation following the development in the U.S. So the U.S. is a country that dominates the top of the billionaire list, and it's been particularly impressive to see over the last 2 years how well the billionaires have done during this COVID crisis. You know, thanks to those rich lists, it's been clear to everybody that that's the group that really did the best during the crisis. So that a fact, you know, really gave a lot of impetus to think about how to tax billionaires. And actually, there was a leak in the U.S. Public debate, you know, by ProPublica, this press organization, that showed that under the current tax system, many of the very richest billionaires don't really pay that much at all in taxes on the individual income tax. And that's why for that group, we need to think about new forms of taxation that could really have a bite, you know, on them. And so there were the wealth taxes proposed by Elizabeth Warren and Bernie Sanders during the primary campaign. Those wealth taxes were designed as a way to really get after billionaires, because in contrast to the wealth taxes that we've seen in Europe, there wouldn't have been any exemptions for stock owned, you know, in companies where you materially participate in the business. because of these exemptions, it means that the equivalent of the Elon Musk, you know, Jeff Bezos before he retired would essentially have no taxable basis. So that's the most important development, that comprehensive tax base, so that because Joe Biden won the election, you know, and he didn't propose the wealth tax, you know, those proposals didn't move forward. But even now, you know, in the coming days, as Democrats finalize, you know, their big welfare state expansion and tax on the rich expansion, there is a call for taxing the rich more, and a realization that what has been proposed so far doesn't really go after the billionaires. So that's why we have this tax specific on gains accumulated by billionaires that Gabrielle mentioned. Those gains would be taxed even before, you know, billionaires realize their gains, which is really the way to go after billionaires in real time. So this proposal, you know, it'd be the first, pretty much the first one in the world as a long shot, but at least it is in the debate.
Thank you, Manuel.
If I can add just quickly, I would say that my feeling is that the conversation about wealth taxes in particular has changed a lot in a couple of years, and ideas that were far out of the mainstream of the discussion among economists or journalists or, you know, civil society in the US or in the political world 2 or 3 years ago now are really considered much more mainstream, and in fact are really center stage. And you know, if you take a broader perspective, it seems to me that the situation today looks very much like the situation of the early 20th century, just before the creation of the income tax. You know, the income tax was created in the US in 1913, in 1914 in France, and in both cases it came after years and in fact decades of debates about, you know, the desirability and the feasibility of a progressive income tax in a context where you had both rising inequality and a pretty regressive tax system, you know, at the top of the distribution. So it can take years, it can take decades, and historical circumstances matter a great deal, but if this parallel is correct, I think there are good chances to see some important developments in the future.
Thank you, Gabrielle. Now a question about gender inequality. So for Anne-Sophie and Teresa, of course, you can jump in the conversation. What would you suggest to tackle gender inequalities?
Yes, well, thank you for the question. I think Teresa mentioned a few examples. Obviously, there's the issue of, in the case of labor force participation, she mentioned social norms, and this is a very interesting issue. It's also an issue in Europe, not only MENA and Latin America. There are many different things that can be done, I think, in terms of providing childcare and having men take their paternity leave, and we congratulate Thomas for taking that seriously, obviously. So there are a number of policies that can be put in place, both to tackle the labor force participation side and to tackle the earnings gap side. There, as you saw, there are different dynamics across regions. Some regions you have an issue of educating or allowing women to go through the education system and reaching higher levels of education. In some countries, women are highly educated, but they don't participate because of norms. In other countries, they would like to participate, but they don't have there are difficulties in having both the family life and a work life, so that hinders them from either participating or climbing the job ladder. So there are really a range of policies that can be put in place. Something that we also saw, that there in some countries, and we still have to dig into that, it's not not exactly the same dimension of policies, but in some countries what we found, we were actually surprised for some Latin American countries by the relatively high representation of women in the top of the distribution. And one way we interpret that is that these countries have both a high skill premium and a high share of highly educated females. And that makes them able, actually, this high skill premium makes them able to hire full-time childcare, private childcare. So there is a tension between high skill premium, which obviously is going to drive income inequality up, and gender inequality, because in those countries, actually, women are highly represented at the top of distribution. This is just a possibility interpretation of our data, and we still want to dig into that.
Thank you, Anne-Sophie. An additional question about gender inequality. In terms of policy to promote more gender equity, there is the quota that's been very much debated, and I was wondering if in the data in the countries that you've studied, you've been able to measure if this is an efficient policy or not.
Well, in the case of the top, the representation of women at the top of the earnings distribution, at this stage we have four countries. I think the quota policy, is not apparent in the data so far. And I'm not sure, maybe I should ask Teresa, I don't think it has been put in place, or at least not very firmly put in place in the countries we have in the study, but we hope to expand our database and be able to tackle that question.
Great, maybe for the next World Inequality Report. Let's open the discussion. Maybe someone else has questions on that? Yes?
Hi, thanks a lot for the very impressive report. And I was thinking about the comment by Lucas Chancel about the new system of national accounts revision, because you take the national accounts as sort of a benchmark in a lot of what you do. But of course, there are lots of ways in which the national accounts can also be improved themselves. For example, like closely held business wealth is often poorly measured. So could the next step be for the World Inequality Lab to cooperate with national accounts or national institutes to guidelines to also improve the data quality of the national accounts themselves?
Thanks. That's a very important point. In fact, we are realizing that when we try to improve distributional statistics in several countries, this also leads to revising, improving the macro aggregates. In many developing countries, we're faced with these issues, for instance, in India. So Jayati Ghosh was talking from New Delhi, and she could have told us, I'm sure, if we had the chance to still be with her in this discussion, she could have told us that in India, there's this big gap between, you know, the growth that you see in household surveys and the macroeconomic growth rates. And in fact, probably the gap is not because one source of data, the micro source, say, is entirely right and the other is entirely wrong. In fact, both need to be improved in order to move forward. So when we make these studies, these DINA studies, this distributional national account studies, I think it's really an invitation to improve both sources. I mean, the macro and the micro. Another point where they also need to be very much improved is indeed when we think about the so-called satellite accounts of the SNA, the national account system. And by this, I mean, for instance, all these physical capital values and databases. So how do you measure the environment? What exactly are going to be the benchmarks for factoring in carbon emissions? So for instance, here we make a clear contribution, which is when you look at total emission levels, we need not only to look at territorial emissions emitted at point of use by French people, but also include emissions embedded in international trade. And we've worked with teams of researchers over the world to, you know, also improve the methods into how to incorporate emissions made in China when you actually are using a service in France. And this so far is not, you know, in the SNA guidelines. So we are also working or trying to work with our partners at the UN in order to improve these as well. So I think that's a very important point, not just the micro, but also, of course, the macro level.
Do we have other questions? Yes?
There's a great deal of material that you're presenting that is fascinating, but one of the most startling slides for me was the one that showed the evolution of the ratio of private capital to GDP. And if I read it correctly, it said that the ratio has essentially tripled in the last 60, 70 years, whatever that is. Is it appropriate to infer from that that the average productivity of capital has dropped by two-thirds? If that's the inference, that's pretty startling. But if you think of the wealth as assets and you think of GDP as the income that flows from that assets, then it looks like we need three times as much assets to generate a dollar of GDP as we used to. Is that appropriate? Is that a valid inference? And if not, why not?
That's a great question. I would say that a big factor behind the rise of wealth to GDP ratios is increases in the valuation of the capital stock. So think, for instance, of Tobin's Q, you know, the ratio between the market value of firms and the book value of their capital stock. That has increased in many countries over the last decades, from, you know, 0.5, 0.6 in the post-World War II decades to more than one sometimes today. And what does that mean, you know, fundamentally, economically speaking? Well, it reflects the many changes that have happened to the relative power of capital owners as opposed to workers or other economic actors. So now shareholders exert much more power upon their firms. They have much more control over dividend policies, over investment, over what, you know, the firm can do. Unions in many countries have much less power than they used to. And when the power of capital owners increases, well, that gets capitalized into asset prices. And you see that process not only for corporate equities, but you also see it for housing. You know, housing used to be strongly regulated in many countries after World War II, with rent controls, for instance, that have gradually been lifted, and that certainly has contributed to the rise of housing prices as well. So that's just, you know, one piece of explanation to say that you don't necessarily need to infer from these trends that the marginal product of capital or the productivity of capital has declined. I think the big story is just these tectonic changes in the relative power of capital owners and other economic actors.
Well, that's probably a fascinating story, and it doesn't sound like it's fully articulated at this point, because if the explanation is that, for example, stocks have appreciated on the expectation that the capital they represent are more productive, well, then once again, you've got the fact that GDP is not growing commensurately. And so why do people expect that their capital is going to be that much more productive when it's not showing up in the growth numbers?
Well, GDP is not growing because if that growth in the value of wealth is at the expense of other economic actors, if it's at the expense of workers, for instance, then, you know, for the economy as a whole, it's you know, it's zero sum, or it's not a one-to-one. You know, it's the increase in the value of wealth is not going to contribute one-to-one to an increase in the value of output. Now, other factors, you know, if you look at a lot of the rise in the value of corporate equities is also probably linked to the increase in market power, in monopoly power, in a number of markets. And so it's the expectation of future monopoly profits that are not in current GDP. Everybody expects that, you know, Amazon and Facebook and Apple will be able to, you know, make even more profits in the future than what's, you know, whatever profits they currently make and that are currently counted in GDP.
Thank you very much, Gabriel. Do we have other questions? Yes, can you please circulate the microphone? We have a... Okay. We'll take it afterwards.
Hi. So, yeah, looking at the findings, they look fairly dramatic, especially there was one claim that the actual levels of inequality are similar to the ones at the end of imperialism era. And it seems very dramatic, and did you consider linking the data with other indicators that would help show a bigger picture to what extent inequality has negative impacts, such as well-being? Is it possible to link data with such indicators?
Are you talking about income and wealth data, or?
Yes.
Okay.
About inequality, yeah.
Thank you for your question.
No, I mean, that's a great point that, you know, we're making first steps towards this integration of other dimensions of well-being. We've looked at gender, we're trying to make contributions on climate. You will see this plenary session on political cleavages and social inequalities, which is another way to make this, you know, extension. But really, this is just the beginning. It took us several years and over a decade to put together these simple things, which are income and wealth, and which appear that they are not as simple, you know, to measure. So there's a long way ahead for inequality research in the integration of these dimensions. And many groups are actually doing that. Some groups are actually doing that, and we hope to be able to connect more our systematic work on income and wealth with indicators like access to health, like life expectancy, and like other forms of ecological indicators. So far we have one, and there are indeed many, many different others.
Yeah, the reason why I ask is I'm doing my PhD on inequality, and my supervisor would always ask me, okay, yeah, I see, so is it bad? She would always ask me that, so hence I...
The obvious thing I want to say is that, yes, we invite all of you researchers, you know, to use systematically the data to correlate, you know, the inequality and changes in inequality with other things. We think this database is a much more solid base, you know, to do that than what existed before. Because you're right, in the end, we want to know why inequality matters, you know, for society. And that's, you know, up to the research to tell us.
Thank you.
I have a question talking about ecological inequality. So Luca, you've been publishing the data about contribution to carbon emissions. We know that the climate is a big issue at the moment, if not the most pressing one. So what can we do about it to tackle the climate warming and to stay under or at the level of 1.5 climate change. Thank you.
Thanks, Olivia. Perhaps rapidly, you know, I think what, you know, Thomas was also suggesting in his introductory words, that the approach taken so far to try to tackle climate change has been very macro, and it has been very often blind to the inequality challenge. And really, I think the Yellow Vest movement is a very sad case study of what should not be done. Because when you're, you know, taxing energy consumption, we've been knowing for many years in the environmental economics domain that, you know, low-income groups are going to be impacted more than high-income groups, and that this can lead to situations of a lot of constraints for low-income energy consumers. And there are other ways to do that. I'm just taking perhaps, you know, one example for, how to do carbon taxation, how not to do it. In British Columbia, Canada, for instance, the carbon tax that was implemented there in 2008 was coupled with strong, generous transfers to low and middle income groups. So basically you use the money and you redistribute it to those who are going to be most in constrained situation. This was not done in 2018 in France. In fact, part of the funds were de facto used to give these big tax cuts to the top 2% of the distribution. So that's one way to do it. The other way really is investments, investments, and more investments. And that's what, you know, all the energy agencies are telling us. We need to increase the value of investment in the energy sector by about 2 percentage points of GDP. So from about 2 points of GDP invested in energy to about 4 points in GDP invested in energy. And the question is, who's going to make these investments? Is it going to be, you know, Elon Musk? And so one actor that is going to concentrate also all the new valuation of the wealth that is going to be generated associated to these investments? Or are public actors going to invest more in these domains? And if public actors do that, who's going to finance that? So here we're back again to the question of our, you know, new solutions to generate more revenues for states and for governments. And I think these are key questions as we also are hopefully going to exit the pandemics soon. Who's going to pay for these new investments?
Thank you. I think we had a question over there.
Okay, thank you very much for your presentation. You made a point about the relevance of power relations, that supply and demand is not enough, that neoclassical economics is not enough. My question is, which are... How can we deal with the theoretical problems which implies to focus on power relations to understand why how inequality is produced? I mean, which theoretical traditions, which are the clue concepts? Just a reflection on that. Thank you very much.
Yeah, I mean, I think this is a good question. It is. I don't have a great answer yet, but I hope, you know, that you researchers, you know, by showing us the data, you know, will then motivate others or yourselves, you know, to think through theoretical development. I really think economics, the way it's done, you know, in classical economics, is not well equipped, you know, precisely to think power. We do have it a little bit for monopoly, as we've discussed, but it's much more pervasive than that in society. You know, there are some models of bargaining, you know, where there is effectively a surplus to be shared, you know, in matching models, but they've remained, you know, limited really to the labor market. I think we need a more comprehensive model of power in economics that then can be used, you know, to study conceptually inequality.
Thank you, Emmanuel. Another question in the audience? Okay, can you circulate the microphone, please? Yeah.
Thank you very much. Very briefly only, first of all, thanks so much for your incredible work, which is very enriching. And one of the messages that I'm going to take home with me is certainly that politics matter, right? So tax policies really may have an impact on the distribution of income and wealth. So my basic question would be, why do you think that increasing the knowledge, which is here now represented in this very impressive report, may not be sufficient to change citizens' preferences for redistribution? I'm not talking about the first 1% or first 10%.
Okay, I'm going to try and rephrase your question. What you're asking is how to increase the willingness of citizens to have more redistribution, is that correct? Well, there are a number of issues. if I can mention just work on South Africa, where the high levels of inequalities were made salient through an experiment. This didn't allow increasing the demand for distribution because there was a lack of trust in government. So I think there is really a tension there between the fact that people, that inequality matters for people, but then they have to trust the government to carry out the good policies to make inequality decrease. And in some countries, and in countries where inequality is high, I believe that trust is lower. So there is this type of vicious circle in terms of generating the good response to inequality issues.
Yeah, I think this is another very critical point, and we're trying to make clear that transparent information is not a sufficient condition for change, but clearly it's a necessary one. And then it also raises the question of how researchers, empirical researchers in inequality, are deciding or not to partner with other groups in society, because you cannot ask the research world to do everything by itself. And the question is, what kind of connections, what kind of ties, what kind of joint projects are developed, for instance, with the media, with some civil society movements? And then it's also, all groups of researchers might have their own answer to the question, but clearly one thing which seems important to us is continue to open more economics, to open it to other disciplines in social sciences, but also potentially to open it more to non-academic actors. This is also what we're trying to do with these sets of tools for people interested in it. And also when we release this report, we're trying to work beforehand with the media, for instance, to try to share our view of what is new here, what's not. And this creates some form of synergy. And I think without more collaborations, yes, the risk is that this work remains within the academia, and I think that's not our approach to things. So more openness is key, but we cannot ask everything to the academic world.
Thank you, Luca and Anne-Sophie. We can take a last question.
Yeah. Here, can you pass the microphone, please? Thank you.
Yeah, so thank you for this really interesting set of presentations. I was wondering if you could maybe say a little bit more about the last question, just on the aspects of engaging with society. So I was wondering, someone earlier had asked about, is it bad? And I was wondering if you could say something about how you engage with those kinds of normative questions as researchers. So what relationship you see between the work that you're doing and questions about whether any given measure that you're looking at would be viewed as good or bad, either from your own as a researcher or from groups in society who might have different stakes or ideas about whether something is good or bad. So the top 1% might say the amount of taxes we're paying is good, whereas a different group might have a very different position. So I'm wondering how you sort of think about those issues.
Thank you.
One thing I want to add on that is that for inequality numbers to have an impact on society, they need to be presented in a way that makes sense to the broader public. And the reason why the top 1% statistics were so successful, it's because they are very easy to understand. In contrast, the Gini coefficient is something that is very abstract, and you've noted this morning, all the stats we've presented were of the form, more accessible, and so I think that's one important element, and then it's a matter of relationships, whether as an academic you will accept, to talk to the media, or perhaps some policymakers want to design wealth taxes, they are going to contact people who are the specialists, on the question, and are you willing, to go and help them. And I think, our view probably of all of us on this panel here is that we think, economics or social science should be useful, for society. So we are generally happy, to engage. And I would like, to invite you researchers, to be open to such engagements as well.
And perhaps, to add a little more on the normative questions. The point is, again, not to have a definitive answer on what is the optimal level of inequality in the society, this does not exist. This is not up for researchers to decide that. This should be the result of public deliberation. But now clearly what we observe is dysfunctional societies where there is extreme wealth, where there's extreme income concentration. And this connects to the other point that was made before about additional indicators. And I think, you know, that's a great question to open up to the third panel discussion that we'll have in this World Inequality Conference on political cleavages and, you know, how very high inequality levels can connect with high political polarization, which is one way to understand why high level of inequalities might be particularly problematic for societies. So more unequal societies are societies that are more tensed around this question of distribution and have less ability to deal with other challenges of the time, like the COVID crisis, like climate change, or like the rising polarization of their electorates.
Yes, I would like to add to what has been said a few perspectives on why inequality matters. One is related in, I work mainly on developing countries, and one is related to the so-called gross poverty inequality triangle. So we have shown that, or it has been shown, research has shown that in high inequality countries, poverty reduction is more difficult. Another perspective is that of political capture, and it's related also to political polarization, the fact that when inequality is high, then there is a risk of political capture by the elite. There's also another perspective, which is related to the difficulty of producing public goods in high inequality context. And a last perspective is actually the correlation between high inequality and low mobility, more low intergenerational mobility. This has been shown in various research throughout the world, and this is also an important aspect.
Thank you, Anne-Sophie. I think we are going to stop here. So thank you, everyone, for your attention and for your presence here and online. We hope that you're very excited about the report, at least as much as we were working on it. And as a reminder, of the web, you will find all the information, the report, the summary, the tables, the figures on the website wir2022.wid.world. Thank you very much.